soul, how amazing was grace. You brought me blessings out of a tragedy.
with faith, rise up, O heart, believe, let faith rise up in me. Let faith rise up, O heart, believe, let faith rise up in me.
Well, good morning. Almost don't need a microphone, but I want to get to the Reese's in the back and make sure everybody can hear me. We want to be so thankful for this special day. This is the first day of Calvin and Tammy Price. Dr. Calvin and Tammy Price is Sunday here. They had a good trip coming over from Mississippi. And they were welcomed with moisture and snow and things that snow covers up the dirt. And so I hope you enjoy this. It won't last too long, but cold weather is just part of winter. So we're so glad to have you here safely. And we're glad to have everyone else is here. A couple of announcements in the bulletin, just be aware of. They're there, and whenever the rest of their belongings get here, we'll see how we can arrange to help get those unloaded and things like that. So let's open up in prayer. Could you please stand? Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we just want to praise you and thank you that in this day of inclement weather, we can come together as a church body to worship you, to honor you, and to glorify you. We thank you for bringing our new pastor here and his wife, Tammy, safely. Thank you for the message that you have to bring to us through him. We pray that you help us receive it. You help us to focus on you. Help us to honor you and glorify you. Help us to worship you in song and reading of the word and studying of the word. And we are so blessed, and we just want to praise you and thank you for what you've done for us and how you provided us with a new pastor. We pray that we could honor you and that you would help us to see your vision, help us to to serve you in the manner that you want us to serve you. We give you this day, give you this time, and pray that you would we would be a blessing to you and you would bless us. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Ray. It's great to see everybody. As I've heard it said before, I guess we can sing people in. And so, but thank you for braving the weather and coming on in. And it's good to see everybody this morning. So let's worship the Lord in song. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He's the great Shepherd, the Rock of all ages. Almighty God is He. Bow down before Him, love and adore Him. His name is wonderful, Jesus my Lord. His name is wonderful, His name is wonderful, His name is wonderful, Jesus my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful, Jesus my Lord. He's the Be seated. As you came in today, I know everybody here is familiar with that, but we've got our church guide here, our church bulletin, which has our announcements in here. And take a chance to take a look at those. Just some good information that we have in there. Also, if you're new to us or if you have any prayer requests, we have a communication card here. And please put in there, you know, if you've got prayer requests, and can turn it in on the basket back there where we do our tithes and offerings, and the church office will be glad to pray for you during that time. I wanted to take this opportunity, now that we've got Calvin and Tammy here as well, but I do want to recognize Ray Cope. He's the head of our pastor, he was in our pastor search committee, but he's also the chairman of our deacons. But over the last year and a half, he's worked very hard to make sure you've always had somebody to bring the message. In church, he's overseeing the day-to-day operations here, and I just want to recognize him and mention him for everything that he's done. So he's in the back working right now, so we thank him very much for that. So if you could bow with me, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day and the beautiful snow that we see. With this snow, I pray that people would be safe as they travel. But we thank you that you've blessed us to live where we live and to work where we work. Lord, as we listen to your word today, both in song and in word, open our hearts. Help us to know what you would want us to know. And help us in all things that we'd be willing to follow you each and every day, even in the hard things, that you will see us through, that you are all that we need. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So our verses today are out of the book of John, John 14:6. Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." You know, these words are so profound to me, and I think profound to us as we hear the words of Christ, that it really is the only way. You know, if you listen to the world, there's all kinds of ways. There's all kinds of religions. They'll tell you there's all kinds of way to be good enough or to reach God or to reach nirvana or reach paradise or whatever. But we know from the word of God, from the truth that he gives us, that it's only through Jesus. But you know what? That's a very simple way. It's not hard. He didn't make it hard. We don't have to do things. We don't have to list of things and do all these different things to reach him. Jesus did it all for us. But let's remember that as we continue on with our service. So I'd like to take this opportunity, if you want to stand, let's greet each other this morning. As we work our way back to our seats, I'd ask everyone to stand with us again. We'll continue to worship the Lord in song.
Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we pray. Almighty infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we pray.
I want to take this wonderful opportunity to introduce Dr. Calvin Price this morning. You know, it's been a year and a half since Brother Jay left and moved to Texas to be able to continue the ministry that he's doing. But we look back. We've talked about this in our pastor search committee, and I know others. I know everybody here has been praying for the right person and the right couple and the right family to be here. And so we're very excited. You know, it's looking back how God's timing is perfect. It always is. And so it's just such a pleasure to welcome both of you to our family, the family of God. You have all your brothers and sisters here. I know you're a long way from home and your kids. That's hard. We know that. But I know God's got a very special place for you here and your ministry here. And we're just so excited to have you here. So, Dr. Price, welcome.
Well, let me say, first of all, thank you so much. I want to thank you for being here today. Scripture says where two or three have gathered in His name, He is there in our midst. And I thank you for braving this weather. I had no idea when we came to Gallup that we were going to enter into y'all call it a snowstorm. I call it a blizzard. But I had no idea that we would enter into a snowstorm like this. But, you know, I must tell you, it is absolutely beautiful outside. Thank you. Thank the audiovisual team for getting here early. Thank our music ministry, everyone who worked in the background this morning shoveling snow, and Raymond for being out there with a snow plow. Snow plows are not normal for us in the South. I want you to know that. That's out of the norm for us. We do get snow occasionally, but nothing quite like this. There's been some times when we've had some large amounts of snow, but usually they last a few days and we're done for the year at that point. I would also like to say I am humbled. Tammy and I are very humbled to be here with you as your pastor. I'd like to thank all of you for the outpouring of hospitality, the cards that were left in the pastorium, the food, all of the amenities that you left. Thank you so very much. It made our lives a little bit easier last night. We're still living out of bags and boxes at the moment, but at some point in the near future, we will find a little bit more of a settled routine there. So we appreciate that. And I also want to say that really in 2013 was our first connection with Gallup, New Mexico, and Tohatchee, and then again Fort Wingate. We had a time there. We knew in our hearts that God would do something years ago with us in this area, but we didn't really understand it. And it took all of these years for God to prepare us for this opportunity. Another way that we know that it was God's will, one, He impressed it on our heart. Another way, there was a lot of obstacles in the way to get here. I won't go into all of that, but I shared with one person the other day that we knew it was God's will because the devil did everything he could to prevent us from coming. But nevertheless, that's just confirmation to me that it's the Lord's will that we're here today. And we thank you. Thank you for being obedient to the Lord. And we look forward to our ministry here in Gallup with you as we work together to reach the kingdom of God. And today, as I say that, I would like to pray for us, and then we're going to open up to Joshua chapter 24 and verse 15. I do want to say that I didn't give a full outline this week because it's been so hectic the past few weeks, but I will be doing that in the future. It's just a title and a text today, but you will be getting an outline to follow in the next few weeks, so I can assure you of that. So let us pray, and then we will get into the Word of God together. Father God, we are so humbled and so thankful to be here with you. We're thankful for our friends that we left behind and the love that they have for us and the love that we have for them, and most of all, the love that we all have for you. But we're likewise equally as thankful for our new ministry endeavor and the new friends that we're making. And we thank you for their love and their outpouring and appreciation. And we know that we will grow in relationship and in love for one another and for you. I pray that you use us together to benefit and grow the kingdom of God for your glory. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. As we look at this today, I want to tell you that the title of the message is Life's Greatest Choice. And now that's singular when I say that, but I want to talk in plural in just a moment. When we talk about choices, life is full of choices. There's choices that you make every day. And I think about what Dr. Adrian Rogers said years ago. He presented the gospel, and he said, this is the choice that you have to make. And you're free to choose, but you're not free to not choose. And the reason for that is, if you choose not to choose, then you have, in fact, made a choice. And so, when you're presented with an option, you have to make a choice. It's either one way or the other. And so a choice is a very important part of life. You chose to brave this snow and to be here today. You chose to be a part of this community. You chose what you were going to put on and wear this morning. We chose which bag to open to find it. But you made choices today to be here. And all of these choices have impacts on your life. There are things in life that we do not have choices over. One is the snow outside. You have no choice when the snow comes. You just accept it, you move along, and you go on with it. There are things in life other than snow. You may not have a choice over sickness. If you get information from a doctor that you don't want to get, you have no choice over whether or not to have the sickness, but you can choose what to do with the sickness and how to live with that. We all have our plights. Well, when we look at this passage that I'm going to read to you in a moment, Joshua had quite a conquest ahead of him. Early on in the book of Joshua, we'll see that he picked up the conquest. You know that. He, after his mentor and confidant in ministry had passed on, Moses died. Moses did not get to see go into the promised land, but he did get to see it. And that was punishment for something else we'll talk about maybe at a later time. But he did get to see it. And so when Moses died, they had 30 days of mourning. And after the morning had passed, what happened was it was time for them to get together and to finish the conquest. It was time to cross the Jordan, and it was time to walk on into the promised land. It was time to get there. Now, nothing from day one had been easy for them. And I want you to know that in the past few weeks, I've changed my perspective on how they felt about leaving things and the familiarity of things. But I also know that we can't look back. We have to look forward and know that in God's plan, in God's timing, if we make the right choices, God provides everything we need day by day. Not maybe. Now, He has it planned months ahead of time, years and so forth. But we may not know that. We just have to trust today. And that's what they had to do. They had to trust each day. Now, I would also like to say that along the journey, they whined and complained a lot. I'm sorry to say it that way, but they did. They complained constantly about everything. We don't like the food. We don't like the manna. We want something else. And they received quail. By the way, they got sick from that. There was one thing or another that they complained about. We don't like this terrain. We don't like the way we're living. We had it better in Egypt. Well, yes, but what they couldn't understand was that they couldn't see what they were going to, and they were only focusing on what they were going through. And so that is a difference that we encounter. We only oftentimes look at what we're going through, and we fail to keep our eyes on God and see the destination of what we're going to. You know why? Because it's hard. It's nothing easy about it. I've said many times that doing God's will is never easy. God never calls you to operate within your comfort zone. He always takes you out of your comfort zone. He does things with you that is unimaginable because He's moved you out of your comfort zone. And when He does that, what happens is you learn to trust the leadership of the Holy Spirit in your life. And that's amazing. They were at a point. They were about to go into the promised land. And Joshua presented them with a choice. When they went into the promised land, they had to go into the promised land with the right attitude. They had to go in with the right perspective. You see, we know that life is full of choices. We know this. And this was a choice that they had to make that was life-changing for them. They couldn't go back to Egypt. They could stay in the desert, but they didn't want to do that. It was time to go in and claim what God had given them. And it says this in Joshua 24:15. Out of the New King James Version. And if it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But I want you to notice this part of the verse. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Now, there's some interesting things about this. He refers to the other side of the river. He's referring to on the other side of the Red Sea, over on further back in time when they were doing all of the things and exposed to all of the Egyptian ways of life and so forth, and how that idol worship seemed to follow them into their new life, and that had to be gotten out of them, and it took 40 years to get it out of them. And so they made their way. But when Joshua gave this choice, it was not a question that Joshua was asking them. This was an imperative statement. Joshua was a military leader. Joshua was a man that had witnessed all of this. He was with Moses from day one on the journey, and he understood all that it encompassed, and he understood how the people thought, how they acted, how they responded. He understood all of these things. But then the military side of Joshua comes out. Joshua gives them a military command. Today, you will choose who you will follow. Today, you will make a decision. Joshua's not asking them if they want to. Joshua's not saying, do you think it would be a good idea to decide today? Joshua didn't say that. Joshua said, today, friends, you must decide. Now, they had a choice to make. Their decision was either not to serve God or to serve God. I think about that in life. You know, we have decisions every day, and every day we are presented with the choice of whether or not to serve God. We are presented with the choice of picking up our cross and following Him daily. We're presented with those choices in life. Sometimes they're very hard. Sometimes we let the flesh win. Sometimes the flesh seems to prevail. And I want you to know God's been working on my attitude for 56 years, okay? So He's been working on it for a long time. It's almost 57. But God's been working on that attitude for a long time. And He's begun to weed it out, but it's not perfected yet. I want you to know that. And so Joshua gave them a command. You see, when we move forward, we have to let go of yesterday. We cannot move forward dragging yesterday with us. Yesterday's luggage, yesterday's baggage, yesterday's problems is over with. We have to move forward. And Joshua said, from this point on, you must decide whom you will serve. Will it be God in the promised land, or will it be the ones on the other side of the river that your forefathers followed? What will it be? Do you know what the greatest choice of all in life is? The greatest choice in life is what we will do with Jesus Christ. You have to make a choice. You cannot walk away from that choice. You see, if you decide, once again, if you decide to walk away from that choice, then you've made a choice to reject Jesus Christ. And that's what we don't want to do. We do not want to reject Jesus Christ in any way, form, or fashion. But that comes every day. Life is full of choices. From the cradle, we face decisions. We've had to choose our friends. We maybe chose college, maybe a career, maybe our soulmate. We made choices in life. Sometimes we've made the wrong choices, and sometimes the choices seems to have detrimental impacts on our lives, and sometimes it has profound impacts on our lives that are positive and good, and they benefit us. Joseph Epstein wrote these words. It comes down to this. We make our choices, and our choices make us. Our choices produce acts which produce character, and character eventually becomes permanent. Wow, what a statement. That is a powerful statement when we think about that. Life's greatest choice is not your vocation, not your job. It's as important as it may be. Life's greatest choice is not your education, as significant as it is. It's not your friends, as critical as it is. The life's greatest choice is not your lifetime mate, as important and imperative as that may be. Life's greatest choice is what you will do with Jesus Christ. That's the greatest choice you will ever make. I want you to know, first of all, it is a required choice. Every person is required to make choices in life every single day. Every person is. And there's one choice that we cannot escape, what we will do with Jesus. I've been asked a question through the years, what if someone didn't have the opportunity to know Jesus? Well, the scriptures also tell us that when we look around and see creation, we are without excuse. We know that it's a higher authority that created the world. We know that this was a orderly design. It was not chaos. It was not an amoeba on a beach somewhere. It was nothing like that. It was not evolution, because they can't explain where the evolution started and where the first things came from. This is about a divine being, God Almighty, the Holy Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, creating the world. And so we are faced with that choice. It is a choice that we make that impacts our entire eternity. But I want you to know that when we choose Jesus, not only does it impact our eternity, it impacts our present. It impacts the way we live, because it changes who we are on the inside. And when the inside is changed, the outside expresses it. I want you to know, when I say this, I'm not criticizing doctors, and I'm not criticizing medication. But today we have a pill for just about everything. If you want to quit smoking, we can give you a pill or a patch. If you want to break a bad habit, they've got a pill or a patch. If there's anything at all that you want to do, there's some sort of pill somewhere that will seemingly help you. There's mood-altering pills and on and on and on. And I'm not making fun of this. But what I'm saying is that there's no pill to change your eternity. There's no pill to change your character. There's no pill to change your integrity. There's no pill to change who you are in Christ. And the only way that you can get that is by accepting Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior. That is the most important choice that you will ever make. When Moses brought down the Ten Commandments off of Mount Sinai, where he had received them, he found the children of Israel immersed in idolatry and sin at a golden calf. And so that day, as we know, he broke the Ten Commandments, but he posed a choice to them in Exodus 32:26. It says, Moses stood at the gate of the camp and said, "Who is on the Lord's side, let him come with me." This was an imperative command. It was a command that demanded an immediate response, and therefore they had to choose that day. They were going to follow Moses to the promised land, or they were going to wander on their own. And I want you to know, it saddens my heart when I think about this world. There are a lot of people that are wandering around on their own. They're living life without hope. They're living life without faith. They're living life without any purpose that they know of or understand. And if you want purpose, and if you want hope, and if you want meaning, then Jesus is where it is, and it's not found anywhere else. Yes, we can find fulfillment in our vocation to some degree. But I'll tell you this, if we are never fulfilled, it may be because we're looking in the wrong place to be filled from, to gain that from. When Moses saw their nakedness, he was astonished and overwhelmed. They had witnessed the miracles of God, and yet they had chosen to turn back to the Egyptian way of life. Life's greatest choice was presented on many occasions to the prophet Elijah. Elijah would have to make decisions to follow God. Matter of fact, his decision to follow God carried him down to a brook Cherith, and he stayed there until the ravens quit bringing food and the water, the brook dried up, and then he moved along, and guess what? He found help from a widow that had just enough flour to make one cake of bread, and they made that. She said, "Well, we're going to die anyway, so I might as well make it and give it to you." And what happened was, because she was obedient and took care of this man, God honored her, and her oil and flour did not run out. And later her son died, and Elijah, she went to Elijah, and she was upset. "After all this I've done, I've taken care of you, and my son is dead. What now?" He says, don't worry. Don't get upset. Your son is not dead." And he brought him back to life. You see, we go through things in life to draw us closer to the Lord Jesus Christ. Sometimes we drift away and we don't even realize it. Sometimes it's through the hardships that we learn where we are, and that we know at that point we need to move closer to Him, that we need to allow Him to work in our lives. I think about another occasion where a choice was presented to a man named Abram. We know him as Abraham. In Genesis chapter 12, God appeared to Abram and said, "Get out of your home country." Matter of fact, He didn't even give him a destination. He just said, "Travel east. I'll meet you along the way." He didn't tell him where you're going. He didn't say you're going to Gallup. He didn't say you're going to California. He didn't say you're going to Mississippi. He didn't say you're going to South America. He just said, "Get out and travel. I'll be with you. I'll meet you along that path somewhere." And you know what he did? He made a decision. He said, "Okay, I'll do this." And God blessed him immensely. God works through some of the strangest and most unusual ways in our lives to get us where He wants us to be. When we look at where Joshua is, Joshua had an awesome blessing to complete the conquest that had begun 40 years earlier. It begun 40 years earlier. And now, here he is. Joshua is not a young man at this time. We know he was probably in his, maybe a late teenager, early 20s, when they began the conquest. And so after 40 years, he's in his 60s. And matter of fact, the scripture tells us that in his late years before he died, that he had the same vigor as a young man as he did as a young man in his older years. There was no distinction in the way that he looked. I'm assuming he had no wrinkles. Maybe his hair didn't come out. I don't know. All of these things just didn't happen to him, but he was close to the Lord. But Joshua made a decision to get up and go on into the promised land. The prophets would go ahead, as you will see later, the prophets would go ahead, and when they would get to the Jordan, they were not to stop. They were to keep walking. And he told them that everywhere the sole of your foot touches will be yours. When the prophets started walking, their foot went down toward the water. The water parted out of their way just like it did in the Red Sea. And they crossed into the promised land. What an amazing thing that would have been to see. And I'm thankful that we have it to even know about today. Joshua's life was approaching its end, and he knew that he had to prepare these people. And so he gave them a choice that day, a command. And he said, you have to choose. He had given them land that they had not worked for. They had lived in cities that they did not build. They had enjoyed fruit from olive groves and vineyards that they did not plant. They had received food directly from heaven that they did not have anything to do with other than God's provisions coming for them. And then he challenged them in 24:15, decide today what you're going to do. You have to. But not only is it a required choice, it's a necessary choice. It's necessary. The verb choose is imperative, and it is in the form of a command, as I shared. Joshua, with his military experience, he was accustomed to giving orders. He had learned from his leader, Moses, and he would give them orders, and they would follow those orders. And again, he was not making a request. He was giving a command. And the poet once said, to every man there openeth a highway and a lane, and every man chooses the way that he shall go. I don't know if God's ever taken you anywhere in your life that you didn't know where you were going, but I'm almost certain that he has. I remember going on a visit years ago. This was many years ago when the cell phones just started getting the GPSs. And I was trying to make a visit way out, and so I put the address in, and I'm driving, and it literally turns into a dirt road. And when I say dirt, I don't mean gravel. I mean a dirt road. And I'm thinking, this doesn't look right. But I keep going, and then it finally says, you have arrived. And I'm like, well, I've arrived somewhere, but I don't have any idea where. I've arrived, but I knew that I had to turn around and go back and start over. And the reason that I'm telling you this is when we're on the wrong road, when we've arrived at a destination we know nothing about, there are times when we need to stop and go back to the source and start over on that journey and stop and listen. There will be things that will come up to keep you from doing what you're supposed to do. There will be things that will be laid in front of you that will change your plan. You will look at it and think, I would much rather take the easy route. This moves me out of my comfort zone. Yes, it will. That's happened to me more than once with a GPS, and it took me a long time after that to learn to trust it again. But as the years have passed, they have greatly improved. I know that. But I've also learned that you can't use more than one GPS at a time, because they do not all give the same direction to the destination. And you can get lost by that. I remember traveling with someone, and they said, we think we can use all three GPSs and get there. I said, I don't think we can. I think we've got to go one route, and that's it. We can't use three, because they're all telling you something different. So how are we going to do this? And there's no security in knowing that we're going to arrive at our destination. But we will arrive when we have Christ in our heart, I assure you of that. Matthew 6:24 says that no man can serve two masters. He will either hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and man, or money, as some would say. But you know what? We have to decide who we will follow. We have to decide that. It's It's very important that we make the right decision. And we do that through prayer. We do that through fasting. And we always look for the easy way. But I want you to know that's usually the wrong way. Because when it's easy, it's usually something that draws us there because of our own comfort and insecurities. But when it's hard, we learn to trust God and to get through. A person cannot choose to be a law-abiding citizen and a criminal at the same time. You have to be one or the other. We cannot accept God and reject God at the same time. You have to do one or the other. There's no neutral ground where Christ is concerned about him. There's no neutral ground. You can't sort of be a Christian. You can't kind of be a Christian. You either are or you aren't a Christian. But I also want you to know, not only is it a required choice and a necessary choice, it is a personal choice. It's a choice that you can't make for anyone else. And when Joshua gave this command, it was a command to each person there to make a personal choice. They had to make a decision. Each person had to make it. No one could make it for you. Your family can't make it for you. Your friends can't make it for you. Your loved ones, that an extended family can't make it for you. We have to choose and make a choice for our own self, and it becomes personal. And we have to seek out what we decide to do. When I surrendered to the ministry years and years ago, my father came to me and he said, "Son, I don't understand." He said, "You've got everything." He said, you have a home. Y'all have great jobs. You just have everything right now. Why would you give this up?" Well, you know what? Later in life, God replaced everything. Boy, did he replace everything. And he gave me a new perspective on life. And not only that, he helped my father to see that too. And that was an important aspect of it. I won't say much about that because I don't want to get emotional this morning. But that was an amazing experience. Every person is responsible for their own decisions. Every person. Do you know what? In today's society, we're trying to pass that off. We try to blame that decisions, bad decisions, on someone else. Well, I'm here because of so-and-so. No, no. Well, I didn't have the opportunity as I was being raised as they have. I was reared differently. No, no. Because let me tell you something. In the Bible, there were wonderful parents who raised bad kids. In the Bible, there were bad parents who raised awesome kids. And in the Bible, there were good parents who raised good kids and bad parents who raised bad kids. But it comes down to this. We make personal choices that change the outcome of everything in our life. Let me tell you this. If you make a personal choice in your life to follow Jesus, then you are making a choice to break out of a cycle, and you're no longer in that cycle, and therefore you can live differently. You can choose to be different. You don't follow the same path that everyone has followed. You follow a different path. People in jail say, "It was because of so-and-so. It was because of this. We made a decision. It was because of drugs. It was because of alcohol. I know those things played a part in it, but let me tell you, every person that did that chose to take the drugs or the alcohol. It was their choice, and it got them in trouble. That's bad choices, but let me give you a good choice. Choose Jesus. Choose Jesus, because he'll change your thinking. He'll change your focus. He'll change your attitude. He will change everything about you. Every person is responsible for their own choices. You know what? You made a choice this morning, and I'm humbled. You made a choice to brave this weather out here and be at church. That is a choice that you personally made. Thank you for making that choice. You see, you had to make a choice this morning, but it was up to you which choice to make. But it was your choice, no one else's choice. In reality, we find that choices can be a good thing. You know, the greatest choices or decisions that I ever made were the hardest ones that I ever made. I was thinking about today being the first day of the new year, the first Sunday, excuse me, of the new year. I know it's the 7th, and I know the 1st has come, but a lot of times people make resolutions for the new year. Do you know what the number one resolution for the upcoming year is? We're going to get healthy. We're going to lose weight. That's the number one resolution. Now, you can see I've made that a few times, but it hasn't worked. It comes down to whether or not we resolve it. You know, a resolution is resolve. That is a place where we draw a line in the sand, so to speak, and we say, from this day forward, I have made a decision to do this. And from that day forward, you have to act on it. It is a point of resolve. As a 13-year-old boy, I sat in a pew in church and resolved that I needed Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, and I accepted Him. It wasn't necessarily just a resolution, it was a point of resolve. So you make the resolution, but then you have to come to a place where it's resolved, where we live by it. We want to exercise. There's all sorts of things. We're going to get better at it. Years ago, I stopped at a truck stop. My son and I was coming back from a hunting trip, and we stopped at this truck stop, and there was a young lady working as a cashier. And it was right around the 1st of the year, and I asked her, and I want you to know I've been very cautious asking this ever since. But I asked her, I said, "Have you made any New Year's resolutions?" She said, "I sure have." I said, "Well, what are they?" She said, "A new man, a new car, and a new job." I'm like, "Okay, well, okay. Bless you." I didn't have a response for that one. But I want you to know, we have choices in life to make. That's what I'm trying to say. Make the right choice. Today, let me ask you, as I get ready to close this message, have you made a choice to accept Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior? Have you? Have you made that choice? If you haven't, I want to invite you to do that. And it's really, really easy. And I want you to know that that's not the end when you accept Christ. It is the beginning. Your life will go through a lot of change. You'll repent of things. Your life will change completely from what it is at current state. And you say, "Well, I'm not a bad person." No, God's not saving you because you're a bad person. He's saving you because you're a lost person. And then the bad, He starts weeding it out of us along the way. You might say something as simple as this prayer: "Lord, I know that I'm a sinner today. And I know today that if I die, I would not go to heaven. And today I want to change that. I want to resolve this. I want to invite you, Jesus, the Lamb of God, my Savior, to be my Savior. I want to invite you into my heart and ask you to cleanse me from this sin. Father, this is about you and what you can do. You have promised me that you would save me and you would prepare a place in eternity for me. And today I'm going to trust you to do it." A simple prayer like that can change your life. You know why? Because it's from the heart. A thief on the cross, his prayer of salvation was this: "Remember me when you get into your kingdom." He said, "Today you'll be with me in paradise." Would you pray with me? Father, as we open this time of invitation, this is an invitation for people to respond and to make a decision. Father, there are many out here that have already made a decision to accept Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, and today I want to thank you for that. And for those that haven't, they're listening through live stream or will watch the service a little bit later, I pray that you will use this message in a profound way to touch their lives. Father, today, as we begin a new year, I pray that you help us to resolve, be obedient, and to follow you no matter where it leads or what it costs. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Would you stand with me? And as you stand, if you need to come and pray, please do. Just come and pray. If you need to come and to the altar or sit on the front row, come pray with me. Please, by all means, I invite you to do just that. But know that this invitation is about you and the Lord Jesus Christ. Come as you need to come.
Just as